Yeah, thank you. Yeah, so yeah, I'm going to talk about quantum algorithms only for ODEs, but you can then also use them for PDEs after discretization. And so this work was in collaboration with Christian Mendel, Martin Schulz, and Martin Schreiber. So first, what is the motivation behind this? So we know that quantum computing provides a better scaling for certain tasks. And so the question is, can we just also take it and have some advantage for time integration for it? And so the outline of my talk is that I first will talk about high order implicit Runge methods and why they are almost great. And then I will talk about what the obstacle is and how we can overcome it. Then I will give some introduction to quantum computing first, and then talk about our algorithm, our Runge-Kutta algorithm for quantum annealers and quantum computers. So first about the Runge-Kutta methods. So if you have got like an explicit, let's say first order method, and you want to increase the accuracy by the 2^n, then you also need to make 2^n more iterations. So the costs for this explicit methods are quite cheap. So let's just imagine you have like a matrix multiplication where n is your problem size, then this is about n^2. And then your cost increase is 2^n times the cost of a single iteration. So in explicit methods, or like especially explicit first order methods, you have a lot of stability issues. And so you can not also not scale your delta t arbitrarily. Let's talking about implicit high order methods. So in this example, I just S order and S stages. And if you want to increase the accuracy by 2^n, you only need 2^n divided by S more iterations. But these costs are much more expensive. So there are faster algorithms, but like a matrix inversion one algorithm would be cubic. I think the fastest are 2.3, so 2^2.3. But let's just assume this is the case. Then our costs is 2^n divided by S times the single cost of a single iteration. And this implicit methods are stable over a lot of regions. And so we do not have to care that much about the scaling of delta t. So if we could overcome this costs of this single step costs, we can actually go to higher order methods and make much larger time steps. And so this is what we want to overcome using quantum computing. So first, let me introduce some concepts of quantum computing. So let's get started by the qubit. So the qubit is basically a two-state quantum system. And two-state means that there are two measurable states. So these are typically the 0 and 1 state. So you can imagine it like a bit. But now you can also be like in a superposition of these two bits. So α0 + β1, where you have that like α² + β² has to be 1 because it's like a quasi-probability distribution. And if you perform a measurement, you can only measure one of the two states. So if you like in one of the superpositions, you will measure the zero state with a probability of α² and the 1 state with a probability of β². So you can also change your basis in quantum systems. So you can go, for example, from the 0, 1 basis to another basis, one which is commonly used as a plus minus basis, not important what this exactly is. But actually it is enough for quantum computing to just be in one basis that is enough for us. So let's say you combine qubits. And so if you have two single qubits and you combine them and you want to write the quasi probability distribution like as a vector, you can do this using the Kronecker product. So you've got the alpha of the first qubit, the alpha of the second qubit. And so the first element is the quasi probability distribution for measuring 0 in both qubits. This would be the quasi probability for measuring 0 in the 1 qubit and 1 in the second qubit, and so on. But now in quantum mechanics, there are also like more arbitrary states, so probability distributions, and where you cannot crack them down to single qubits, and one calls them entangled qubits, which is some kind of correlation. So basically, if you've got like a high order, a lot of qubits and you combine them, you can get to any 2^n when n is your amount of qubits and dimensional space where the space has to be L2 normalized. And yes. So let's talk about operators on this quantum system. So the operator we are going to need is the so-called Hamiltonian. And so this Hamiltonian defines the energy of a quantum state. So I have now written psi for a quantum state, and so psi can be just some collection of qubits here. And so if you want to determine the energy of the system, you take the scalar product. So if you imagine that psi, this psi is like a vector, and this other one is like the block complex conjugate vector, then you can take the scalar product over the Hamiltonian and then get your expected energy. But if you like would measure your energy, you would see that you cannot get every energy outcome, but there are like only discrete energy outcomes in a lot of system. Here on the right hand side, I've depicted this in a spring mass system, where this red curve would be your potential energy of your spring. And in a classical system, you could be in any of the states, and any energy would be possible. But in this quantum system, this energy is like discretized and like a set of energy states, like E1, E2, and E3. And states which have like a deterministic energy are called like this eigenstates of this Hamiltonian. And if you measure them, they will only have always have the same energy. So then the measurement is not probabilistic anymore. So this Hamiltonian also determines the time evolution of the system. But in the following, we will only be interested in the eigenstates of H, and these are stationary in time. So we do not have to care about this. So let's talk about how you can actually encode any information in qubits, or how information is actually put into qubits. So the most trivial one is basis encoding, which is the same what you do in a classical computer. You just take the bit combination and put your qubits in the same state. So if you've got a bit combination of only zero, you take all your qubits into the zero state, and so on. And this is really fast, so you can prepare such states really fast on a quantum computer, and you can also measure them really fast, because you just measure them, you get your answer. But this needs the most qubits. So what most algorithms do, and so there are also a lot of algorithms for PDEs, they use amplitude encoding. And in this amplitude encoding, you have a vector which has to be L2 normalized. And then you can take this vector and put it into the qubits as a quasi probability distribution, so as a superposition of your qubits. This allows you to make a really dense encoding, but it comes with some drawbacks. So the first drawback is this: preparing such states is really difficult. And secondly, if you want to read out the states, you have to perform something called quantum tomography. And this is really expensive. So in the last year, 2 years, there has been a lot of progress to for certain PDEs to make the state preparation faster, and also the quantum tomography faster, to get to algorithms which are really can be really applied in the in real world cases. So another encoding is the so-called Hamilton encoding. So in Hamilton encoding, you actually do not put any information in your system, but it's more like a framework how you can specify optimization problems on a quantum computer by defining an optimization problem where you the solution of the optimization problem is given in the eigenstate of the lowest energy level of the Hamiltonian. And this is really neat, because a lot of optimization problems really map naturally to it. Furthermore, currently you can use quantum annealer to solve them, which are more advanced than universal quantum computers. And when quantum computers get better, you can switch to quantum computers. However, this is like no real information encoding, so you do basically do not store any information on the system used doing this. So I will talk now first about some frameworks of quantum computing. So the most common one is quantum gate computing, which is you have some qubits and you build a circuit. And you basically apply gates to it. So in this circuit, you have a qubit Q1 and Q2. And you first apply a gate to the first qubit, and then a gate to the first and second qubit. And such a gate is nothing more than a matrix. So for the one qubit, it's a 2x2 unitary matrix. And for two qubits, this would be a 4x4 unitary matrix. And what is really awesome for building quantum computers is that you can have like a small set of gates. And with the small set of gates, you can build any custom gates without too much effort. And so it's basically like in classical computing, where you need two gates to be Turing complete. This is a similar thing for quantum computing. So another framework which we will use later is the adiabatic quantum computing framework, which is if you put your solution to a problem into a Hamiltonian, the ground state of a Hamiltonian, so HS, you can first initialize your system to initial Hamiltonian, where you actually already know the ground system to, and then initialize your quantum computer to this ground system. And then now you perform a transition and you change your Hamiltonian from this initial Hamiltonian to the solution Hamiltonian. And if you do this slowly enough, the system will always remain at the lowest energy level. And then at the end, you can read out the solution to the optimization problem. So the question is, how fast is this? And so this time complexity is actually determined by the two lowest energy levels of your Hamiltonian, but unfortunately not of your initial or your solution Hamiltonian, but of the Hamiltonian, of the path of your Hamiltonian, so of the whole transition progress. And then your time complexity is given by 1 divided to the gap squared. So let's talk about quantum annealing. So quantum annealing is actually not the same as quantum computing, because there are things you can do on a quantum computer which you cannot do in a quantum annealer. But it is quite similar to adiabatic quantum computing in such a way that you also define a solution Hamiltonian, and then you can find the ground state of the solution Hamiltonian. And the idea is, I think most of you may know classical annealing. Classical annealing, you start with a high temperature and you can reduce this temperature and you can jump from local minima by to better local or global minimas by going over this boundaries between the local minimas. And so intuitively quantum annealing is faster because we have like a tunnel effect and can tunnel through this minimas. And so we can find faster this good minimas. So in the following, we will use this quadratic unconstrained binary optimization Hamiltonian, which is given here, where you have some weights of qubit interactions. So one, you can define weights for qubits itself, and then you can define any weights between two qubit interactions. And so this maps to current quantum annealer hardware implementations fairly well. But in the future, it could be also, if the hardware changes, that you can also describe multi-qubit interactions in your Hamiltonian. And so in this cubo, your sigma, so the values get in the end, are element of 0 and 1, so like bits. And so for the D-Wave annealer, for this specific implementation by a company called D-Wave, which is like the company known for quantum annealing, there has been so far no exponential advantage found compared to classical computing. However, that doesn't mean that they are not fast or that there are polynomial advantages. And once you can switch to adiabatic quantum computing, there will be advantages. So let's talk about our Runge-Kutta and how we want to map it to the quantum annealer. So you want to define it as an optimization problem. So let us first only consider linear ODEs, autonomous ODEs. So just ODE where the time derivative is given by some matrix time U. Then we can write our Runge-Kutta with the Butcher table where we only need A, B, and C. We don't need C because we have an autonomous system as this linear equation here, where we have got our initial time, UTM, and we have got the time we want to estimate, UTM plus 1. And K are the stages, so the Runge-Kutta stages. And we have got our Runge-Kutta table A and B here. And so to make an optimization problem out of it, we take the mean squared error of this linear equation. And then if we minimize it, we take the estimated UTM plus 1. And this is the next solution for the next time step we get. So this comes with some problem because U and K, they are obviously in R or even in the couplings number, but let's just assume they are in R. And but the cubo only takes binary numbers. So additionally, we have to insert a binary number representation to do that. And so what we used, so best thing is to use a linear binary number representation because then we do not get any more qubit interactions. And if we used a fixed point iteration number representation for it with some additional offset D, which we will use later, and we basically put the point, we decide a resolution with a parameter k as well. But so to get good resolutions, we actually need a lot of resources, a lot of qubits, and we do not want to do it. So what we do instead is we do something called a variational algorithm. So in a variational algorithm, you start solving the problem with a really coarse number representation. Then we get some outputs and some estimation of our Runge-Kutta problem. And then we update our number parameters and we iterate over this multiple times to get the accuracy we want to have. So this requires less amount of qubits. And so what we exactly do, so we update every iteration our number representation by some constant C. And so you do not want to update your accuracy too fast, because currently quantum annealers are really noisy. And if you do this too fast, then you will get stuck somewhere because there's a lot of noise in the system. And we also have to change our offset in such a way that we always cover the whole interval of the numbers which in which the solution may be. And so if we do this, we did this for here a simple 2D coupled differential equation, and we used a sixth order Gauss-Lechondre method to do this. We used a time step of 0.5 and we used 3 qubits for each number and a total of 15 variational iteration steps. And we obtained this results on a D-Wave 2000 view system. And you can see the result here on the right. So the analytical solution is given in the solid with the solid line, and the annealed solution is given in the dashed line. And so you can see that the solution, so the annealed solution does not match analytically perfectly, but it's going, let's say, in the right direction. And if we compare it like with the numerical solution, on a classical computer, you'll find that the numerical solution on a classical computer is much better. And this had multiple reasons. And the actual reason is that the noise in the current quantum annealers is like really enormous. So you have to make a lot of iterations to get really your best solution. And because of this noise, we do not actually converge to the real solution in this case. So maybe we could have make more variational iterations, or you always make a statistics and run your algorithm multiple times to get better solution. This is something we could also have done, but we only had limited computing access to it. So yes. But now let us talk about the time complexity. So once the noise issues, et cetera, are fixed and quantum hardware gets better, what can we expect from this algorithm? So how fast it gets. And so the first problem is for quantum annealing, there is no really framework for it. And so we switched to adiabatic quantum computing, because there we have got a framework to determine the time complexity. And so then we have our solution Hamiltonian is the cube Hamiltonian of our problem before it. And first we started with assumption that our minimal energy gap is in the solution Hamiltonian and not on this pathway. And then we wanted to find the gap between the lowest energy state and the second lowest energy state in this cubic problem. And so we could not find any closed form solution on it, but we could give a lower bound on this energy gap. And if you look at this lower bound energy gap, so delta x here is the number resolution of our number representation. So this is not any spatial resolution here. And delta t is the time step of the Runge-Kutta method. And b is the smallest element of the vector b in the Runge-Kutta table. But what you can see is that this does not depend on the feature size of the problem at all. So we run some simulation to verify that the minimal energy gap in H cubo is also the minimal energy gap in the time-dependent Hamiltonian. And so here we, for example, run it for the Kranz-Nicholson method. And we could actually see that this method scales with delta x instead of delta x squared, which shows that this bound here is actually not really tight. So probably we can do better, or at least for some methods we can do better. So if you use any specific Runge-Kutta method, and it also depends on the differential equation you use, you might want to make a better analysis of how fast the algorithm can be. And so if we also go to a lower time step, our energy gap will be bigger. And so we inserted into this, for example, the Chebyshev-Gauss quadrature. for which we get that b is 1 divided by s, then we can get some upper bound for the time complexity of this. And so in this case, it depends on the amount of stages we have. And but it again does not depend on the problem size, which is really interesting for taking implicit one-code analytics. So furthermore, we can also extend this algorithm to nonlinear ODEs, but for the nonlinear ODEs, we do not have this, we do not have any time complexity because this would be much more difficult to obtain anyone. We cannot find any boundary for this one. But for the nonlinear ODE, we consider nonlinear ODEs, which you can write as a polynomial equation. So we are using some tensor notation here for up to the power of n polynomials. And so if you crack this down and do the same thing as we did before to the cube Hamiltonian, you will get multi-qubit interactions. So actually you will not only get 3-qubit interactions, but much higher qubit interactions dependent on to which order of m you're going. And so on current hardware, so this might change with different quantum annealing or hardware and on adiabatic quantum computers, this is not necessary. But on current hardware, you have to map these interactions to 2-qubit interactions. And we used a method called reduction by substitution method to do this. So furthermore, this problem is not convex anymore if you use nonlinear ODEs. Then our variational approach does not is not guaranteed to work anymore, which means we cannot really save any hardware resources with this approach anymore. So as example, we use this Riccati equation, the derivative of u is given by u minus u squared. And since we did not calculate it on the D-wave annealer, because the noise would be just too big, and instead we used a quantum simulator for it on a classical computer without noise. And we used this variational approach and used the Crank-Nicholson method with 2 qubits per register and 10 variational iterations. And the result is seen here on the right-hand side. We used a reference solution using Runge-Kutta 4 with much smaller time step sizes. And the ideal solution is given here in blue in the dashed line. You can see that this anneal solution does not match the Newton's method. So the Newton's method is actually using the same, also the Crank-Nicholson method. So this is the numerical solution on a classical computer of it. But we expect that if you, mathematically speaking, your optimization problem, so the ground state of your optimization problem is the same as the Newton's method. So we actually checked that analytically that these are the same. So you would expect that if you if you cancel this variational approach and you make use much more qubits to get a better representation, that you can really get to the ground state of your problem and find and best Runge-Kutta estimation. So you can make implicit, you get the same as if you use the Newton's method with small enough time steps. But you can go to even higher time steps because the Newton's method, you have to start with a point where you are where you're converging. But with the quantum annealing or adiabatic quantum computing, you can also start at a further away point and still converge to the right solution. So let's come to the conclusion. So we had in the beginning that we want lower computational costs for this high order implicit methods to make them more viable. And so we presented a Runge-Kutta method on quantum annealers, which can also be mapped to adiabatic quantum computers. And on quantum annealers, it's already possible for small scales to demonstrate that it is working. And we also generalized this to nonlinear ODEs. So thank you for listening. And I'm happy to take your questions.